Hi, my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor of computer science and psychology, and I study how people reason with data visualizations. On this channel, we talk about how to make better visualizations, how to evaluate your visualizations, and today we're diving into a question about what makes a good visualization. In the previous video, we talked about expressiveness as a way to evaluate how effective your visualization is. Today, we're gonna talk about a new term that goes hand in hand with that previous term. You might get these a little bit confused, so feel free to refer back to these videos to keep it straight which term is which. This term is effectiveness. So what is effectiveness? A visualization is more effective than another if the information it conveys is more readily perceived than information in the other visualization. So this is thinking about two visualizations, and say you are using very similar visualization types, but what you want to do is determine which one is more readily perceived. And there's a great deal of research that can help you identify which approach would be more readily perceived. Let's look at a few examples. Okay, here we have two circles, and I want you to answer the question, how much larger is the area of the big circle? I'll give you 5 seconds to do it. All right, what do you think? I want you to remember your answer. You can write it down or just remember it. And we're going to compare how easy that judgment was to this judgment here. I want you to answer how much larger is the big bar? And I'll give you 5 seconds to do that. Okay, what do you think? In the end, what I would like you to be able to do is to reflect on the process that you used to make these visual comparisons. And if we look at these side by side, what you probably did for the one on the bottom is you took the length of the small one and you multiplied it across the length of the larger one and estimated about 7 times larger. And you would be correct if that's what you estimated. This is a fairly straightforward visual judgment because our visual system is actually pretty adept at imagining these different segments across this line here. Fairly effective. But what did you guess for the circle situation? Well, you probably had to do some process like this where you are mentally imagining these different circles. And this is very, very hard. When I first did this, I guessed about 5 for the circles. The correct answer is actually 6.98 times larger. And the calculation doesn't fit the circles in perfectly, but suffice to say that that judgment is definitely harder. Harder to calculate the right answer, obviously, and also hard to visually do the analysis. Every time you look at a new visualization, I want you to think about how your eye moves around the visualization to try to extract the information. And that can start to give you clues about how easy or hard a visualization is to interpret. But in these two examples, it's fairly clear that the version with the bars is easier to interpret. It is more readily perceived to make this visual judgment than the one with the circle. Okay, let's do another example. I'm going to show you a set of numbers and I want you to answer how many 3s are there. And I want you to do it as quickly as possible, but I also want you to think about how hard it is for you to do it. Okay, how many 3s are there in here? Did you figure it out? No, probably not. You're probably still scanning through. You're probably doing what's called a serial search where you're having to scan line by line by line by line. Right. Pretty hard, especially when I'm talking at you. Okay. Compare how hard or easy this version is to this version. You can see the 3s pop out and there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 3s. Okay. You can just count them because they are more readily perceivable when this is the way that they are visually displayed. One more. How many 3s are there? I hope you can see that we can make visual information more readily perceivable just by changing the visual treatment to that information. But what we would say for these types of representations is that the ones that are more readily perceivable are more effective. The goal of visualization is, in part, one of the goals is for information to be easy and effective to interpret. That's kind of the baseline goal. We add on more goals after that. Things like memorability, trust, how much it inspires people, etc. But at a baseline, we want them to be easily and effective to perceive as quick as possible. Now, the field of data visualization has systematically evaluated virtually all of the different encoding types that you can use to determine which are more or less effective or readily perceivable than others. And they've done so with many, many studies. I'm highlighting here the most famous, probably, which is by Cleveland and McGill. It was one of their very first studies to systematically evaluate how things like position or area are easier or harder for us to perceive. They showed people visualizations like this, and they asked questions like, what proportion is the smaller mark section to the larger? And the mark sections are these little dots here. This was from 1984, so you'll forgive the quality of the rendering. But they basically asked people, how much smaller is this one than this one? How much smaller is this one than this one, etc. And they were able to evaluate how effectively people could make those judgments for these different types of encodings. The important difference here is that for these two, these bars are aligned on the same base and they're close together. These are aligned on the same base, but they're further apart. These are even separated by bars. These are not aligned on the same base. So in this way, they go through and systematically evaluate each element of a visualization to give recommendations. And they do it for various visualization types and look at different types of judgments, like proportional judgments. And this is the type of data or results that they get from these studies, where they can rank the different encodings based on error. So what you're seeing here is position, different types of position that we've illustrated here, have less error than length, for example, that has more error. Now, many researchers, I'd say probably 100 studies at this point, have reevaluated the Cleveland and McGill findings across different data sets, different data types, interactivity, etc. Here is one of those replication studies that looks at the same findings with crowdsourced results, and by and large, all of these results hold. Other studies have looked at a wide range of other encoding techniques, looking at things like direction of motion, velocity of motion, color, and on and on and on. We're talking about the entire field of data visualization. A large portion is dedicated to identifying which different channels are more or less effective than another. Now, luckily for you, researchers have summarized the vast majority of this perceptual research, so you don't have to read hundreds of research papers. And one of the best summarizations, in my opinion, is this organization by Tamara Munzner. What she's done in this fabulous book entitled Visualization, Analysis, and Design has summarized this research in figures like this and, you know, throughout the entire book. But this is one of the most famous figures. And what it is sorting the different channels based on their effectiveness. So what we have here is position along a common scale is most or more effective than volume 3D size interpretations. So you can use a figure like this that summarizes the effectiveness to determine which type of encoding you want to use. So I would encourage you to look at work like this, another work as well. But using this figure, you'll want to focus on trying to use the encoding channels in the higher portions here that are more effective than those in the lower ones. And that will help you ensure your visualization is as effective as possible. We also have channels for categorical values. So what we're seeing here is that spatial relationships are slightly more effective than shape. Now, the nice thing about these recommendations is that they're always being updated. I've heard from a very reliable source that there is going to be a new version of this book coming out. This original one was, I think, from 2014. So there should be one in 2025, probably, coming out that will be updated based on all of the newest perceptual research. And so you'll see more of these types of figures that summarize the vast body of visualization research in an easy, digestible manner. Now, in addition to using recommendations from Tamara Munzner's book and others, I would encourage you to train your own eyes. This will allow you to intuitively begin to understand what is easier or harder for users of visualizations. So let's take a moment to do a little bit of self-reflection, and I'll give you an example of thinking about how to train your eyes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show different words on the screen, and I would like you to name the color of the ink that the words are printed in, not what the word is itself, okay? Name the color of ink. And as you do this, I would like you to think about how hard or easy it is for you to do this task. This task is formally called a Stroop task in psychology, but it is a useful tool to help us think about our metacognition or how our mind is thinking and feeling, okay? So you are going to name the color of ink, and I want you to think about how hard or easy it is for you to do that. Okay, are you ready? Let's begin. What's this? This? this, 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 this. Okay. Did you remember how hard or easy it is? Probably. Now I want you to store that in your mind and compare it to this next word. We're going to do exactly the same thing. I want you to name the color of ink, okay? But think about how hard it is to do so. You ready? Here we go. This,
this,
this. Okay. What do you think? Easier or harder? Ultimately, what I'd like you to be able to do is to be able to intuit that the version on the left was easier than the version on the right. I'm sure you've noticed that. This is a very glaring example. But when you're making your own visualizations, you're going to be faced with dozens, almost hundreds of choices. And as you're going through selecting the color palette, selecting the mark type, selecting the typeface, selecting the organization, choosing what title to place, figuring out where the annotations need to go, your goal should be, among others, to make things easier. So the more that you can train your own eye and your own intuition to feel when something is easy or to feel when something is hard, the more you can start to make those strategic choices rather than having to always refer back to books or papers, etc. I definitely encourage you to lean on these really great books, but they're not going to cover every use case that you're going to be encountering. You really need to find it in yourself, and that will help you speed up the process. Okay, so that was effectiveness. And effectiveness works hand in hand with expressiveness. These are two ways of evaluating how effective a visualization is. I just want to reiterate that this is just the beginning. This is sort of the bare minimum. We are trying to make sure that visualizations are expressive in that they're expressing all of the facts in the data set and only the facts in the data set as a bare minimum. And beyond that, we want to make sure it is also effective, that it is using all of the visual channels, all of the choices to help people perceive the message and data as readily as possible. Okay. Beyond that, you're looking at things like, is it visually appealing? Is it enjoyable? Is it fun? Is it memorable? Those are all additional goals that you can add on top of the visualization, but at a bare minimum, it needs to hit these two markers to be a good visualization. Thank you so much for watching. I hope this was useful in helping you figure out methods for evaluating how good your visualizations are. I will put the Amazon link to this book, which is absolutely worth a read, as well as the links to some of those papers that I mentioned in the description to this video. If you have any other questions or there's topics you'd like me to cover on data visualization, please comment down below, and I'll see you next time.